Blimp Engineering, how China's self-developed airship sets world record, can airships make a comeback? China's domestically developed floating airship, Jimu 1, set a world record of atmospheric science observation at an altitude of 9,032 meters on 15th May, 2022. Jimu floating airship. The airship ascended with a speed of 30 meters per second from a base camp at an altitude of 4,300 meters on Mount Komolonga, the world's highest peak, located on the China-Nepal border at 1:26 a.m. Beijing time. At 4:40 a.m., the airship hit 9,032 meters above the mountain's peak of 8,848.86 meters, setting a new world record. The surface of the airship is made of advanced composite fabric that can withstand temperatures as low as negative 70 degrees Celsius. Weighing 2.625 tons, the floating airship has a volume of 9,060 cubic meters, and the vehicle attached to the bottom of the airship weighs 90 tons. The observation apparatus on the airship is mainly used to record atmospheric composition data and the water vapor transmission process in space. The measurement data includes black carbon, dust, carbon dioxide, and methane, which are key elements in studying the environmental changes in the Qinghai Tibet Plateau. What was the largest airship ever made? The largest airship ever made was the LZ-129 Hindenburg, a German passenger airship built in 1936 for transatlantic flights. The Hindenburg went down in flames during one of the most spectacular and well-publicized transit accidents of modern times, just 14 months after it was built on 6th of May, 1937. The German airship caught fire during its attempt to dock with its mooring mast at Naval Air Station Lakehurst. The accident caused 35 fatalities from the 97 people on board and an additional fatality on the ground. The incident marked the end of airships being a means of public transportation of the so-called Age of Airships. Why you rarely see airships? The main reason you never see airships in the sky anymore is because of the huge cost it takes to build and run them. They're very expensive to build and very expensive to fly. Airships require a large amount of helium, which can cost up to $100,000 for one trip, according to Wilnenchenko. And the price of helium keeps going up due to a worldwide helium shortage. It's also no small feat to fly one. According to the Federal Aviation Administration, only 128 people in the United States are qualified to fly airships, and only 17 of them are paid to do it full-time. On average, it takes pilots 10 to 15 hours to learn how to fly a single-engine plane, but in order for a pilot to go on their first solo trip in an airship, it takes 250 to 400 hours of training. Another reason that airships phased out was due to improvements in aircraft technology, drones, and helicopters that allowed for better surveillance and much shorter travel times. Can airships make a comeback? On June 15, 2022, Valencia-based Air Nostrum, which operates mostly regional routes in Spain on behalf of Iberia, announced plans to order 10 of the airship aircraft Airlander 10, a new generation of the classic airship being developed by Hybrid Air Vehicles, HAV, in Bedford, England.
We're bringing a future of sustainable aviation into the market. We've had Air Nostrum with us here today, who'll be the launch airline customer for Airlander. 2026, they're going to have a 100-seat Airlander aircraft flying in the domestic Spanish network.
Sailing below 3,000 meters or 9,850 feet, passengers will be able to open windows in its non-pressurized cabin, untroubled by vibration or turbulence. More yacht than airplane, the Airlander can gently land on grass or water.
The versatility that it brings into the picture is that it's an aircraft that can take off and land anywhere, inland, or on water, and that opens up and enhances our network possibilities tremendously. So we're really looking forward to being able to introduce this to the family.
It's 92 meters in length, make it the longest aircraft in the world. With lift and buoyancy provided by helium, an inert non-flammable gas, the four-vector thrust engines that power the Airlander 10 can run on relatively little fuel. It produces up to 90% fewer emissions than conventional aircraft of a similar payload, according to HAV.
It's designed to deliver 10 tons of freight, 100 passengers, and to deliver them to places or take them to places at only 10% the emissions of other aircraft.
What's more, these figures are achieved by using conventional jet fuel, but HAV promises that it will be possible to transition to hybrid and eventually fully electric propulsion. The company is already working towards this goal with the help of Collins Aerospace and the University of Nottingham.
Well, again, we are very motivated to embrace any novelty in terms of reducing the CO2 emissions. I think we are really committed to take that as one of our obligations to the planet and to the environment. So when the Airlander was coming into place and they announced that 90% of the CO2 emissions could be reduced on a typical regional route, yeah, we were really motivated, and we're happy that we've managed to conclude this transaction.
The only downside is speed. The Airlander 10's maximum speed of 130 kilometers per hour or 81 miles per hour is no match for modern jetliners, but does it really matter for short distances?
Well, it's obvious to see Airlander's a little bit different. So Airlander's designed to sit in between the services that we're used to getting on fast aircraft and between the services that we get on trains, road or rail. So it's at an intermediate speed point, it's a completely different journey experience, and it's a more direct connection. So what Airlander does is provides us a new transport category. It opens up new links, new ability to provide resilience, serve new markets.
Air Nostrum may use the Airships on some of its high-demand, short-distance routes, such as those operating within the Balearic Islands or between the archipelago and the Spanish mainland.
It is clearly an addition to the business. As I said, it's not really meant to substitute anything. It's to exploit the new aspects and new capacities of this aircraft. It's innovative. At the same time, it's an addition to something that we already have.
The Airlander 10 gondola will be able to carry up to 100 passengers, which happen to also be the capacity of the largest aircraft in Air Nostrum's fleet, the CRJ-1000. If all goes well and the Airlander 10 enters commercial service in 2026, a larger version capable of carrying up to 200 passengers, the Airlander 50 with 50-ton capacity, could potentially follow.
And looking to the future, 2026, of course you have a deadline for delivery. What's the timeline looking like?
Well, you can expect to see us launch production this year. We'll be doing it from the UK. We want to bring 1,200 new aerospace jobs into South Yorkshire to do that. You'll then see the Airlander certification fleet flying in 2024 and then going into service 2026. Really cutting the emissions on that aviation network, initially in Spain and then around the world.
If you're worried about turbulence, officials say the sheer size and low cruising altitude of the Airlander helps it withstand large gusts.